What's up, cinephiles? Right away, I want to get into it by yet again making a needy and undignified plea for you to subscribe to this YouTube channel and leave a comment to say that you've done so, but also that you should buy my book, The Films That Made Me, an edited selection of my essays and reviews for The Guardian, by clicking on the link below. And if you're unsure as to how that actually works, then relax and enjoy this brief instructional video.
Simply click on the link below and it'll take you straight through to the Waterstones page. It couldn't be easier.
There you go. There's no excuse not to get your debit card out now. First film up is Spencer, written by Stephen Knight and directed by Pablo Larraín.
Mummy, what happened to make you so sad?
Well, here, in this house, there is no future. Past and the present are the same thing.
Diana, they can't change. You have to change.
You have to be able to do things you hate.
You hate?
There has to be two of you. There's the real one and the one they take pictures of. Diana, for the good of the country.
For the country?
Spencer is a film which imagines an emotionally stifling Christmas which Princess Diana spends at Sandringham with the dysfunctional Windsors in 1991. Charles, the Queen, the whole uptight crew, as she realises that her marriage definitely is at an end. This is a clever, entertaining film with a very good impersonation of Diana by Kristen Stewart, who gets the voice and the head-dipping, shoulder-shrugging gestures down. In some ways, Lorraine does to Stephen Knight's script what Yorgos Lanthimos did for Deborah Davis and Tony McNamara's screenplay for The Favourite, the drama with Olivia Colman as Queen Anne. Take an essentially conventional, well-made screenplay and produce it like an experimental opera without music. Spencer is a good film, which is almost machine tool to win prizes. It is well made, in fact rather beautifully made, clearly better than the awful 2013 film Diana with Naomi Watts, but very self-conscious, and one of the things that it is self-conscious about is its evident superiority to TV's The Crown. It tells us this is a classy piece of big screen art cinema, jagged, painful, extravagantly ironised, not like that silly forelock-tugging nonsense on Netflix. But if you want to luxuriate in royal gossip without feeling guilty, then here you go. And yet it basically takes the same received opinion attitude to Diana as The Crown, and indeed as that Naomi Watts film. If they really wanted to challenge or interrogate the myth, they might have dramatised, say, Diana's relationship with her mother or with her son's nanny, Tiggy Leg Bourke. And Kristen Stewart's performance, though undoubtedly very accomplished and destined to be seen in 100 award ceremony clip reels, is not in fact quite as good as Emma Corrin's relaxed portrayal in The Crown. Kristen Stewart does get the biggest laugh of the year when her Diana irritably dismisses her sour-faced maid so she can be alone, snapping, "I want to masturbate." I've received another letter from a viewer, Seven Samurai Smile, who says, "Dear Pete, your insights are moderate, as are your subscriber numbers, but what is most annoying are the title card audio stings with silly sound effects, which really are f***ing annoying." I'll try to keep them to a minimum. Next up is a film produced by Martin Scorsese and written and directed by Paul Schrader, The Card Counter.
You count cards, right?
I'm not that smart.
But you win. You need someone to stake you.
That's what you do. You run a stable.
I'm always looking for a good thoroughbred.
Having been sentenced to 10 years in prison, I learned to count cards.
How'd you do that?
Poker's all about waiting.
Check, raise, re-raise, call.
Oscar Isaac, his sleepy-eyed address to the camera making him look tired, gaunt and lizardly, plays William, a professional gambler who drifts from casino to casino, counting cards at blackjack. That is, by memorising every single card played, he can calculate the exact moment to bet big. But he always keeps his winnings modest and stays under the radar. And incidentally, if you're interested in this subject, then the book to read is Beat the Dealer, by the mathematician and inventor of card counting, Edward Thorpe. William is lonely, driven by obsessive guilt, very like Travis Bickle in Schrader's script for the 1976 Scorsese classic Taxi Driver, because he has learned his card skills and his fierce self-discipline in military prison. But then two important people unexpectedly come into his lonely life. One is Lalinda, attractively and sympathetically played by the always likable Tiffany Haddish. She is a talent spotter looking to recruit William to a pro syndicate. but the other is a disturbed young man called Cirque, played by Ty Sheridan, who tries to interest William in a plan to murder someone of their mutual acquaintance. In reply, William merely offers to take Cirque on the road to mentor him in the ways of gambling. Is he trying to cure him of violence using cards? Or is gambling simply going to reignite violent rage in the hearts of both these men? This is a hypnotically watchable gambling film with the squalor, though not exactly the humour, of Robert Altman's California Split and the doomed mentor relationship of Paul Thomas Anderson's Hard Eight. I also strongly suspect that there is a reference to the Thorold Dickinson classic, The Queen of Spades. There's a horrible, queasy urgency to this high-stakes game. Now, a tiny footnote. Last week, Laura Marcus died, a brilliant cultural critic who had important things to say about the birth of cinema and its relationship with modernism. She wrote many books, of which one was this, Dreams of Modernity. In this, Marcus says that the four key themes of modernity in this period from around 1880 to 1930 were psychoanalysis, cinema, detective stories, and railways. Psychoanalysis offered us the idea that for the first time we could understand our dreams, and by that token ourselves. Cinema showed us types of dreams compellingly displayed up on the big screen while the audience huddled in the quasi-sleep of movie theatre darkness. Detective stories were addictive texts which functioned like machines, finally producing a disclosure, a truth which had been withheld from the reader the way the truth of a dream might be withheld from the waking person afterwards. And these detective stories were hugely popular at railway station bookstalls. And Marcus suggested that what was important to movie history was not so much the dream, but perhaps the reverie, the idle waking dream, enabled by the novelty of the train journey, whose speed and efficiency appeared to cancel space and time. You are allowed to zone out and daydream during a train journey in a way that you can't exactly walking or driving. The length of a substantial train journey, an hour and a half, 2 hours, was analogous to the length of a film. Cinema and railways were analogous leisure experiences at the birth of the 20th century. If you're a film student, or even if you're not, reading Laura Marcus is a must. Okay, I'm out. Remember what I said about subscribing to this channel and giving it a like and a share on social media. And please, please leave a comment below to say that you've subscribed. Be seeing you.